are so many voices that are speaking into us today, and everyone that speaks has a worldview, which dictates their belief, which dictates their stance, and therefore there's great opposition, great conflict, even violence behind so many voices. There are voices of the protesters, both sides. There are voices of politicians, both sides, voices of health experts, and even voices of preachers, whether they be false or true. You heard about the Reverend. I think he's maybe appointed as the new congressional chaplain, who ended his prayer in his first congressional meeting with amen and a woman. Oh, my lands. Just makes me just want to die. That's why I want us to listen to the true voice, the real voice, and the voice of Jesus as he spoke to the seven churches in Revelation chapter 2 and 3. The chosen number of seven symbolizes perfection. Seven always symbolizes perfection, completion, fullness. And so the idea is by picking these seven churches, they fully represent all the churches throughout the New Testament church age. These were seven actual churches in Revelation 2 and 3, and they were actually not prominent churches. One or two were a little larger, but these churches were nowhere near as prominent as the church in Rome during this time, or the church in Jerusalem, or the church at Antioch. So they seem to be randomly chosen churches, but actually there are seven perfect descriptions and evaluations of Jesus of what the church would look like through the successive periods in the New Testament. And that's what I believe. There's some debate, but I believe each church represents a period pointing to the end and the last church to the rapture. I think this first church, the church at Ephesus, was the church from about 30 AD to 100 AD. And I believe the last church we'll look at, Laodicea, represents about 1900 AD to the end of the rapture. And we can find all these in every church, and we can apply these, and they're meant for us, they're recorded for our instruction. But I think the prominent virtues of each church represents the beginning of the new church, its birth, all the way until the time of the rapture. So if you look at the Laodicean church that we'll look at later, it's a perfect representation overall of the church across the world right now. With that in mind, look at the statement on the screen. The virtues and the sins found in individual churches often reflect those of the families of that church, which in turn reflects the sum of each individual. Now, I'm not going to predominantly focus in this series on a lot of teaching facts. I'm going to do this a little different than a Bible study. We're not going to give all an extensive description of the cities these churches were in, because I really think pastorally what God is leading me to do is do more application in our individual churches, our individual homes, and then as families. And so instead, we're going to look more closely at what Jesus' instructions are, what he points out, and then how to apply those. Because if I'll take that and look at for that in my church, I can then say, okay, how does that look in my family, which families make up the church? And then what does that mean to me? I have to start with me individually. How do I reflect what's in my family? Now look at the next point. Revelation 2 and 3 are Jesus' last recorded words to his church on earth. To each church in Revelation, and to every church today, Jesus reveals that he is watching us closely. He declares, I know. And so most of us have said at some point, I think I've said it before, that the words to the apostles at the very end of the Gospels and in the book of Acts, where Jesus gave the Great Commission and everything, we said those are his last words. But in reality, these actually are the last recorded words Jesus spoke and recorded to the church on this earth in this church age before the rapture and the millennium and the new age to come. So these are his very, very last words. And he speaks to the church in Revelation chapters 1 through 3 19, he mentions the church 19 different times, but beginning in chapter 4 until the tribulation and great white throne judgment in Revelation 20, he doesn't speak again. Thus, the song I selected that you see in our sermon video, sermon introduction. Listen to the words to that song again. They perfectly apply to our Lord Jesus as he looks at the church and believers today. He says, every breath you take, every move you make, every step you take, I'll be watching you. Every single day, every word you say, every game you play, every night you stay, I'll be watching you. Oh, can't you see you belong to me? How my poor heart aches with every step you take, every move you make, every vow you break, every smile you fake, every claim you stake, I'll be watching you. With that in mind, let's look at the church at Ephesus, the first of the seven churches, Revelation chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, verses 1 through 7. Write to the angel of the church in Ephesus. Thus says the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand and who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your labor and your endurance, and that you cannot tolerate evil people. You have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and you have found them to be liars. I know that you have persevered and endured hardships for the sake of my name and have not grown weary. But I had this against you. You have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember then how far you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. Otherwise, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. Yet you do have this. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Let anyone who has ears to hear listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. I want you to notice first what Jesus approves in the Ephesus church. In verse 1, he gives the picture that he holds every church in his hand, all the pastors of those churches. He is instructing as they lead those churches. And in verse 1, it pictures him walking in and throughout the churches and watching everything, watching every breath and every step we take. He is watching every word we say. He's watching every single day. And Ephesus has an outstanding list of commendations. As he watches, he says, man, here's some things you're doing really well. And his commendations are something every staff and overseer and congregation member of this church would love. They're exemplary. I want you to see the three broad categories that he praises in your outline. Look at the first broad category. He praises their works of faith, their labor or toil of love, and their endurance through hope. In the Greek, these three words are very, very descriptive words. They're very commendable. They're very, very active. This points to a church that's very alive, very active. The three words in the first sentence of verse 2 are tightly linked together. So let me read verse 2a again. I want you to see the exact combination of these words and how they fit together. He says, I know your works, your labor, and your endurance. Then he goes on to say they cannot tolerate evil people. He says, I notice your works, your labor, and your endurance. These exact combination of words are used also as Apostle Paul commends the church in Thessalonica in 1 Thessalonians. They're the exact same combination, but they also give the motive behind it. Look at 1 Thessalonians 1:3. Notice this combination of words with the motivation behind them. Paul says, we recall in the presence of our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor motivated by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. Notice that the works were brought about by faith. Now, faith is not our source of salvation. Our works are not our source of salvation. He's not saying because you work, it led to your faith. What he's saying is works are a natural byproduct of genuine faith. Because you were saved, because of your faith, there's works. Matthew 5:16, in that passage, Jesus says, "Let your light so shine before men that they'll see your good works, and they'll glorify your Father who is in heaven." Notice Jesus also commends their labor. That word labor, I put toil next to it because it has a strong meaning of wearisome labor. It means working so hard you absolutely work to the point of exhaustion. In the Gospels, we see times where Jesus literally just became weary. He was ministering so hard unto the Lord. And the church had Christians, and Paul mentioned one of his co-laborers who had worked so hard almost to the point of death. And in our church today, we have individuals and we have families that toil for the Lord. Just literally, they work extremely hard. To work to exhaustion for Jesus shows that one loves Jesus. And a third connective trait to the works and labors is patient endurance. It means that in spite of obstacles or trials or opposition or conflict, there was a hope in Jesus that led to patience, endurance, and a keep moving on mentality. Keep on keeping on. Anyone can catch a spark and serve Jesus for 3 days or 3 months or a year or two. But when great difficulty comes, Jesus commends those who stick with it. He commends a faith that is exhibited through works, a weariness that comes out of just love for Jesus, willing to just wear ourselves out for him, and an endurance that keeps on keeping on no matter what. Look at the second commendations. 2b talks about these, and he says, "And that you cannot tolerate evil people. You've tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and you've found them to be liars." Look at that second area. Discernment, intolerance and rejection of unholiness, sin, and false teaching was the second area that he commended them in. They're a very discerning church. They did not tolerate false teaching. They didn't tolerate sin. They didn't tolerate unholiness in the congregation. They were teaching, verse 6 talks about the fact that they didn't follow the Nicolaitans. We don't know exactly who they are. There's two or three guesses. I think what I'd leave it at for you is that the Nicolaitans, what we do know, is somehow they taught that the spirit and spiritual things were separate from the flesh and fleshly things. Thus, someone sexually could do what they want and it didn't affect their spirit or the spiritual realm. However, God indeed has stated very clearly that sex outside of the realm of a husband and wife and covenant before him does affect us spiritually. It's rejected by God. It is going to result in discipline and consequences. So this church didn't in any way tolerate people who taught those unholy things. They also tested everyone who came in who said they had the authority of an apostle and that God had given them certain doctrines, and they would show when they were not true apostles. So poor teaching and unbiblical doctrines, pop psychology, false religious practices that worked their way into church, false religion and those practices, outright paganism, they rejected all of those things. Those are things that you certainly find heavily in the churches today, but in that church, there was none of that going on. They had stood hard against that. They hated false teaching, false doctrine, false teachers. Look at the third broad area that they were commended in. They had persevered, endured, and not grown weary through hardships. Verse 3, "I know that you have persevered and endured hardships for the sake of my name and have not grown weary. Most can do well in serving Jesus when things are good. But what he's saying is you've done well when the circumstances seemed cursed rather than blessed. A lot of people have slowly, their love grows cold because they say, God didn't bless the dreams I had for my job or my finance or my spouse or my kids or the respect people grant me or how much money I have or my ability to do some of the recreational things I've always wanted to do or the dreams I had for my life. This group had continued to endure regardless of their circumstances or suffering. And earlier it had said that they had worked to the point of weariness, but here notice it says they had not grown weary. Well, a quote from Dwight L. Moody, I think, answers that. Look at his quote. He says, I grow weary in the work, but not of the work. This was his answer to his wife when she was telling him, you've got to slow down. You're exhausted. You're weary. You keep taking on more and more. And he said, listen, I grow weary in the work I do for my Lord Jesus, but never of the work I do for him. Christians should feel blessed. Our goal, what Jesus commends, is us laying our head down exhausted every night and yet smiling and saying, Lord, to the best of my ability, I love you so much. I gave everything I could to you today. I'm exhausted, but it's a good exhaustion, and you will help me to not grow weary of the work. This was an active, doctrinal, evangelistic church. But there was one thing, and it makes me shudder. I've thought about it over and over again. He says, all these incredible things you've done, but he said, I hold this one thing against you. Look what Jesus rebukes in the church, verse 4. But I have this against you. You have abandoned the love you had at first. Notice in your outline, they had abandoned their first love. When asked what the greatest command was, Jesus didn't even hesitate. He said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. And there's another like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. First John is written by the apostle who was referred to as the apostle who loved Jesus. Of all the apostle John was very, very close in the inner circle of Jesus. He had a tremendous love. And when he addresses love as a topic in 1 John, he says a love for Jesus and other believers is evidence of someone who is close and abiding and walking in Jesus. Think of the apostles and how their love for Jesus motivated their works, their labors, their endurance. The apostles embraced truth and passion and spiritual fruit and unity and on and on. Look around your church or look around our church here at Faith Baptist. I don't have to look too far in my church to see individuals and families that absolutely love Jesus. And because they love Jesus, they love to obey him. Because they love Jesus, they love his word. Because they love Jesus, they trust Jesus. Their hope is in Jesus. They find their joy, regardless of outer circumstances, in Jesus, and on and on. To love with all your heart, soul, and mind means it is a love that envelops everything in my mind, my thoughts, my will, my passions. Let me give you a number of areas of what it means for Jesus to be our first love. If he's our first love, it affects our desires. It's conforming our desires to those which please and honor God. Love, deep, intimate love for Jesus, wants what pleases and honors him. It doesn't feel like it's being cheated if it can't get drunk. A true love for Jesus doesn't want to get drunk. It's not looking for the next party. It's not prioritizing self over others because that doesn't please God. It's not acting independently of God. It doesn't reject all authority that God places. It wants what pleases and honors God. A love for Jesus that way wants to please him. Secondly, to love Jesus in that way affects our affections. It's that we love those things that God loves. We get really excited about what he loves. God loves righteousness. And we get excited about those things. It's patient, kind, gentle, humble, all of those things. It's 1 Corinthians 13. Love endures all those things God loves. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is gentle. Love is forbearing. It hopes all things, believes all things, endures all things, doesn't hold an account of wrong suffered. All of those things central. So it means that we can love our jobs, we can love recreation, we can love our relationships, we can love our families, but it means we love Jesus in the middle of all of those. Where's Jesus in my job? Where's Jesus in my recreation? Even if I'm recreating, I want to be filled with Him. I want Him to nurture my soul. I want to slow down so I can see Him. I want to see Him in nature, all of those things. Look at the next area. It's loving Him is loving Him with our purposes. We pursue those things that God would have us pursue. Love pursues other believers. It wants relationship. It doesn't want to be isolated from church and other believers. It pursues God's word. It pursues His righteousness. It pursues reconciling just as He reconciled with us. It pursues communion with God and worship and truth. Pursues the equipping that other believers give when they're together of all the gifts of God. Look at the next one. It affects our will. To love Jesus as the first love, we choose that which is good in our lives. We don't choose evil or sin or destructive or selfish or vindictive or judgmental or critical things, but good deeds, good thoughts, good goals, good words. Look at the next point. Loving Jesus as our first love impacts our feelings. We subject our feelings to the truth of God. It has been a strong move in the American church that people have turned to, here's my feeling, what I perceive God wants me to have, what I perceive God spoke to me. And what we do is instead of placing God's word and His truth as the engine of the train, and thus letting the feelings be the caboose and follow that engine, we flip those. And we say, how I feel is most important. God wants me to be happy. God wants me to have this. I think God wants me to leave my marriage and have this other relationship. I think God wants me to have the freedom to do what I want to do. I think God wants me to feel good, even if I had to compromise or reject His word to do so. So if I want to have an abortion, in my mind, that's best for me. It's my body. I have my own independence. No man, nobody can tell me what to do. Therefore, God embraces that. If I have sexual sins or struggles with sins, even in some area of homosexuality or something, I will just say that's the way God created me rather than saying, what does His word say? Because I choose that which is the truth of God's words. I subject my feelings to that. Look at this next one, our character. We pursue holiness and godliness and purity. A lack of love doesn't care what anybody thinks about our actions. But love for Jesus comes out in that we become all things to all people so that we might win some of them to our Lord Jesus. And then finally, love affects our thoughts. We meditate on the truth of God's word and live every day in light of it. Even the subject, even the thoughts of our inner heart are subjected to truth and doctrine. We even find ourselves, I want to capture even my thoughts to His word and His truth. Now listen, it's impossible to humanly live like this. We just don't do it. And it makes us go, when we realize listen, what God's saying, if Jesus is our first love above everything, and the Holy Spirit is filling us and drawing us to Jesus, these kind of things begin to show that He's our first love. He's that which is most important. So Jesus gives three practical responses. Look in the outline what Jesus instructs His church to do. He said, well, what do we do if we've fallen from this one area? How shuddering it is to see so much doctrine and activity and evangelism and discipleship, and yet Jesus says, this one thing is so important, I'll remove you as a church and remove you as a pastor if you don't embrace this. He says, here's what I want you to do. He said, number one, remember. That seems kind of hard to do. What he's saying is forgetfulness is often the beginning of spiritual decline and falling out of love with Jesus. He says, remember constantly, daily, do not forget the fact that you were once a child of your father, the devil. You were once outside looking in with no hope, alienated from God. At one time, you were dead in trespasses and sins. You deserved death and hell. But remember Christ's love. Remember the joy set before him to endure the cross. Remember the crown of thorns on his head, his love, his telling Peter, don't die by the sword. Remember his teaching, his care, his healing, his forgiveness of sinners and restoration of them. Remember his grace that covers our guilt. We have to remember those things daily, because when we start forgetting those things, we begin falling out of love with Jesus, and we begin doing philosophies and practices and things instead of the relationship. Religion becomes important and relationship becomes secondary. He says, secondly, repent. He doesn't say confess. Confess is just to agree that something's sin. He said, I want you to repent, which means you're moving one direction and you literally take steps to change that direction. Don't just acknowledge the problems. Determine what it's going to take to eliminate that sin or that weakness, or reprioritize it, or begin doing something that you haven't been doing that will help that. Focus less on religion and more on Jesus Christ. Change direction. Identify what has slipped up there, and then don't just say good sermon or that's a good word. Say, I'm going to respond. I'm going to repent. And then the third thing is return to the works motivated by love for Christ and others. I keep thinking it should say there, return to Jesus. Return to him. Return to his love. What he says, if you'll fall back in love with me, you'll return to these passionate, strong works done out of the joy of your relationship with me, your faith and your love. Remember when worship used to be the highlight of your life. Remember that new relationship with Christ. Now, you were just overwhelmed with his love, the tears that would come when you think about how much you loved. Remember the passion and the love-fueled weariness you had of just serving Jesus. You come home bone tired, but you'd say, it felt so good. I endured, just couldn't stop. Remember. Spend a lot of time this week going back every day and remembering. And then repent. Come up with a game plan of what you're going to change. And then return to passionate work. The churches are almost dead in works today. We're so lukewarm today. We're the Laodicean church. We're certainly not this church at Ephesus. Look at the final thing. Jesus closes each church's evaluation with all seven churches with these words. Let anyone who has ears to hear listen what the Spirit says to the churches. He tells all seven churches, he says, I'm watching you. I'll be watching you. I'm evaluating you. You're going to have a job evaluation as a Christian every single year. And I'm telling you what I commend and what I don't commend. His words were so strong to this church that was alive and active and doctrinal, so much further along than the church today. He said, if you don't deal with coming back to your first love, I'm going to remove your lamp. I'm going to remove you as a church. He doesn't say that as an individual. He says as a church. And certainly we've seen that happen a lot today. That church was responsible for completing all the New Testament we read today. They attempted to evangelize the entire Roman world. They consisted of the apostles. That age, that church was the birth of the church. It was so strong. But it's appropriate to keep with the main thing. And I'd have you consider the wisdom of Solomon. If you want to listen to a voice, read Proverbs every day right now. The wisest man God had ever created or would ever create, he said this in Proverbs 4:23, watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flow the springs of life. What's in your heart? Is it Jesus? Is he your first love? If not, return. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you so much. Jesus, you're so incredible. Our world is so dark, and we are so stretched and so oppressed and so anxious. So many voices yelling at us every day, demanding our allegiance, demanding we accept them as truth. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and we love him. Lord Jesus, through your Holy Spirit, give us the power to make you our first love. And I pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.